Tantor Audio presents Cronkite's War, His World War II Letters Home, by Walter Cronkite IV and Maurice Isserman. Narrated by Michael Prichard. Foreword. By the end of the 20th century, Walter Cronkite was one of the most famous Americans of his time. He carried the coveted title, the most trusted man in America, and, to generations of younger viewers, he was known as Uncle Walter, the steady and wise man guiding the country through so much tumultuous change from his anchor desk on CBS Evening News. To those of us who shared his profession, he was a role model as a journalist and also as a family man, a father and the husband of the incomparable Betsy, a winsome woman he met in the early stages of his career in Kansas City. To their many friends, and I was proud to be in that company, they were simply Walter and Betsy, a matched pair with a zest for life. Whether it was a sailing vacation, an opening night on Broadway, buck seats at the Kentucky Derby, or at a sing-along after a dinner party. Their sense of adventure started early, for they were married in 1940 on the cusp of World War II. When the future of the free world was to be determined in what some military historians have called the greatest single event in the history of mankind. By 1942, Walter was headed for that war as a correspondent for the United Press. The next year, he was based in London and covering the war on a daily basis, primarily by reporting on the dangerous bombing missions of the 8th Air Force. London, that most elegant of cities, was on a full-time war footing, blacked out at night to discourage German airstrikes, living on reduced rations, and trying to accommodate the crush of newcomers who poured into the British capital to launch the counterattack against Nazi Germany. In this remarkable collection of personal letters from Walter to Betsy, the listener is transported back to the pivotal years of 1943 to 1945. When the push against Hitler's war machine was beginning to have its effect. Betsy was back in New York with their beloved Cocker Spaniel, Judy, for what would prove to be a long separation. In the straight-ahead, honest prose he later became famous for as an anchorman, Walter mixed the momentous, the personal, and the ordinary in his dispatches to Betsy, worrying about how to make his meager salary cover room, meals, and wardrobe. War correspondents in those days wore special uniforms, which they had to purchase, and they drew rations, such as one big Tootsie Roll, vanilla wafers, cheese niblets, a carton of cigarettes, and a box of razor blades. At one point, he let her know that his share of a room was $18 a week, explaining that the price may seem exorbitant, but that space was scarce. Walter's days and nights were long and irregular, and he often told Betsy of his exhaustion, brought on by working through the night to hammer out an account of a bombing raid, and then to get it through the censors and onto the wires for transmission to the United Press, UP newspaper clients in the U.S. It wasn't all work and no play, however. Walter came to be a drinking pal with Clark Gable, the big Hollywood star who had enlisted and flew combat missions with the 8th Air Force. He began a lifelong friendship with Andy Rooney, and his UP boss was Harrison Salisbury, a legendary journalist for my generation. A bar was always open somewhere, and it's plain that Uncle Walter enjoyed a nightcap. His most famous assignment that year was also the most dangerous. The gifted young men who covered the 8th Air Force persuaded Army brass that they should be able to accompany a bombing mission over Germany. Remember, this was at a time when casualty rates were high because the bombers didn't have adequate close air support and the German homeland was laced with air defense weapons. Cronkite flew in the plexiglass nose cone of a B-17 during the raid and later admitted that he manned the 50 caliber machine gun against German fighter planes when they were attacked over the target. His bomber made it back safely, but a plane carrying a New York Times reporter was shot down, and his body never was recovered. Cronkite's first-person account of the raid, the first ever written by a journalist along for the ride, received wide play and high praise across the United States. But in his letters to Betsy, He remained characteristically matter-of-fact in describing the stack of congratulatory messages he received. As I read these letters, I longed to see Walter and Betsy again so that I could tell them how much I enjoyed them and how much I admired their unconditional love, which comes through after all these years. The letters to Betsy also reminded me of how the two of them and all of their friends from that time kept up their enthusiasm for taking life head-on. Think about it. They were front and center for World War II. And yet, when it ended, they were on to the next big story, and the one after that, and the one after that. A gregarious couple from America's heartland who relished all their opportunities and loved each other deeply until the very end of their quintessential American story. Finally, and I'm sorry, I can't help myself, that's the way it was. Tom Brokaw. Character Key. Dave Anderson, New York Times correspondent who briefly shared an apartment with Cronkite in Brussels in 1944. Adele Astaire, entertainer and Fred Astaire's older sister. She appeared with him on Broadway in The Bandwagon in 1931, but gave up the stage when she married Lord Charles Arthur Francis Cavendish, becoming Lady Cavendish. Phil Ault, United Press correspondent in London, covering the air war. Hugh Bailey, president of United Press from 1935 to 1955. A former police reporter, he was known as a martinet and proud of his reputation. Frank Barhite, an old friend of Cronkite's. Edward W. Beatty, Jr., veteran war correspondent and United Press bureau chief in London. He was captured by the Germans in France in September 1944. Lowell Bennett, International News Service correspondent in London. He was shot down over Berlin in a U.S. bomber raid in November 1943 and described his captivity in Germany in his book Parachute to Berlin, 1945.
Irving Berlin, America's favorite songwriter, whose works include White Christmas and God Bless America. His wartime show This Is the Army played on Broadway in 1942 and then went on tour to military bases overseas, including England. Berlin appeared in the production on Broadway and abroad singing, "Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning." Ronald Reagan starred in the 1943 movie version.
Homer Biggert, New York Herald Tribune correspondent and member of the Writing 69th who went on the Wilhelmshaven raid. In 1946, he was awarded a Pulitzer Prize for distinguished reporting from the Pacific. He remained with the Herald Tribune until 1955, when he switched to the New York Times, retiring in 1972. Bill Bonney, Associated Press correspondent who landed with the 82nd Airborne in Operation Market Garden. Harold Vincent, Hal Boyle, Associated Press columnist. He won the 1945 Pulitzer Prize for Distinguished War Correspondence. Bert Brandt, photographer for Planet Acme, the United Press Picture Wire Service. He covered the D-Day landings. Robert W. Kattenhauser, Kansas-born Army Air Force second lieutenant and glider pilot. Ronald Clark, British United Press correspondent who helped cover Operation Market Garden and was later assigned to the Brussels Bureau. Ward E. Caldwell, Kansas City Bureau manager of the United Press in the 1930s. Helen Fritchie Cronkite, Cronkite's mother. John Charles Daly, CBS radio correspondent in London. After the war, he hosted the weekly What's My Line panel game show on CBS from 1950 through 1967. Raymond Pete Danielle, New York Times London bureau chief. His book, Civilians Must Fight, 1941, reported on the Battle of Britain. Elmer Davis, head of Office of War Information. Clifford L. Cliff Day, United Press London bureau manager. William Boyd Bill Dickinson, United Press correspondent in London who handled the desk rewrites on the air war. A Missourian, he joined the UP in 1930,
was assigned to London in 1940 to cover the Battle of Britain, and in 1943 left for a new assignment in the Southwest Pacific reporting on General Douglas MacArthur's campaign. He covered the Japanese surrender on board the USS Missouri in 1945. After the war, he served in editorial and executive positions at the Philadelphia Bulletin until his retirement in 1973. Leo Bill Disher, United Press correspondent in London covering the air war. He later became chief of the UP bureaus in Czechoslovakia and the Balkans. William Randall Bill Downs, a former United Press correspondent and one of the Murrow boys with CBS Radio during the war. Robin Duff, BBC correspondent famous for covering the Blitz and D-Day. John Durston, New York Herald Tribune correspondent in London.
Ira C. Aker, 8th Air Force commander.
Joe Evans, Newsweek London bureau manager. Eugenia Lincoln Jinx Falkenberg, model, actress, former tennis champion, and socialite who married Tex McCreary. Harry Ferguson, veteran United Press sports writer and assistant general news manager. John F. Jack Frankish, United Press correspondent. He arrived in England in spring 1944 and was killed during the Battle of the Bulge, December 23, 1944. Edward Uncle Ed Fritchie, Cronkite's uncle, his mother's only sibling. Jack Fritchie, Cronkite's cousin, and an Army Air Force officer. Clark Gable, a leading Hollywood actor and the star of Gone with the Wind, 1939, who enlisted in the Army Air Force in 1942. Promoted to captain, he was assigned to the 8th Air Force to make a recruiting film for aerial gunners. He flew combat missions as an observer gunner. Cronkite refers to him in letters to Betsy as the face. Gordon Gaskill, American war correspondent who landed on Omaha Beach on D-Day. He spent Christmas Day 1944 with Cronkite in Luxembourg. Martha Gellhorn, veteran war correspondent and Ernest Hemingway's third wife. She spent Christmas Day in 1944 with Cronkite in Luxembourg. Louis H. Gertes, former United Press correspondent who worked for the Office of War Information's Foreign News Bureau during World War II. Walt Graebner, Times London bureau chief. He had reported for Time and Life on the Battle of Britain, and his book Their Finest Hour, co-authored with Time correspondent Alan A. Michie, was published in England in 1940 and in the United States the following year. He later reported from the Soviet Union. Frederick Graham, New York Times correspondent in London. Joseph W. Grigg, a veteran United Press foreign correspondent who covered the start of the war from Germany. After the invasion, he was assigned to Paris and later became UP's Paris bureau chief. Samuel Dale Hales, United Press correspondent in London, covering the air war and the war in France after the invasion. Dudley Ann Harmon, one of the rare women war correspondents employed by the United Press in London. She later covered the war in France and the Nuremberg trials. Eric Hawkins, New York Herald Tribune correspondent. Hawkins published the last edition of the Paris Herald Tribune in June 1940 as the Nazis approached the city. His memoir, Hawkins of the Paris Herald, 1963, includes a vivid description of wartime London. Charles Bill Higginbotham, United Press correspondent in London covering the air war. Gladwin Hill, AP correspondent and member of the Writing 69th who went on the Wilhelmshaven raid. Like Cronkite, he was head of his wire services air war desk, which made the two of them fierce, if friendly, rivals, eager to be the one to file a story first. After the war, Hill worked at the New York Times from 1946 to 1979, for which he covered the Kennedy assassination and became a pioneer of environmental reporting.
Earl J. Johnson, United Press Vice President and General Manager in New York.
Judy Cronkite, family Cocker Spaniel. George Kirksey, 8th Air Force Public Relations Officer and a former United Press sports writer. Betty Knox, London Evening Standard reporter and a former star of vaudeville and the music hall stage. Morrow Crum, Army Public Relations Officer. He was killed in an air crash in Iceland on May 3, 1943. The same crash killed Lieutenant General Frank Maxwell Andrews, commander of U.S. forces in the European Theater of Operations. Frederick Koo, United Press correspondent in London, Berlin, Moscow, and Manchuria, who became chief London correspondent for field publications in 1942. There was no diplomat Koo did not know, Harrison Salisbury recalled, no foreign office's man he had not dealt with. Bill Laidlaw, major in 8th Air Force Public Relations. Larry Lesueur, joined CBS Radio in 1939 as one of the Murrow Boys, covering the London Blitz, D-Day, and the liberation of Paris, before winding up in Belgium in December 1944, where Cronkite met him. He left CBS for The Voice of America in 1963. Boyd Lewis, United Press correspondent covering the fighting in Belgium. Edward B. Lockett, London bureau chief for Time magazine from 1942 to 1944. He later covered the White House for Time. Elmer Lauer, Office of War Information Field representative and former United Press reporter and bureau chief. He later worked with Cronkite at CBS News and became president of ABC News in 1963 and dean of the University of Missouri School of Journalism in 1982. Charles Lynch, Canadian reporter working for Reuters who landed on Omaha Beach on D-Day. He later covered the 2nd British Army with Cronkite. Paul Manning, CBS radio correspondent hired by Edward R. Murrow and a member of the Writing 69th who did not fly on the Wilhelmshaven raid. Later in the war, he moved to the Mutual Broadcasting System, and after the war he served as a speechwriter for Nelson Rockefeller. Bob Manning, sometimes referred to by Cronkite as Nephew, or Nephew, he was the son of Betsy's eldest sister, Laura. Manning was about the same age as Betsy and Walter, and the three were very close. According to family lore, Manning was serving in a hush-hush military capacity during the war. Hilda Marchant, chief feature reporter for the Daily Express and author of Women and Children Last, a woman reporter's account of the Battle of Britain, 1941, before joining the London Daily Mirror as a daily columnist. She was also Bill Dickinson's girlfriend. According to Harrison Salisbury, she was as widely known as any woman in wartime England. Alan Maxwell, Betsy Cronkite's brother. Arthur Maxwell, Betsy Cronkite's father, referred to as Petty in the letters. Betty Maxwell, Betsy Cronkite's sister-in-law, married to Alan Maxwell.
Eva Maxwell, Betsy Cronkite's mother, referred to as Mole, or Molo in letters.
John Reagan, Tex, McCreary journalist and public relations specialist who rose to the rank of colonel in the U.S. Army during the war. He married Jinx Falkenberg and later became prominent in Republican Party politics. Jim McGlincy, United Press correspondent in London covering the air war and Cronkite's friend and roommate. He later covered the ground war in France and Belgium. Henry McLemore, syndicated columnist for Hearst newspapers. Drew Middleton, arrived in London to cover sports for the Associated Press and stayed on to cover the war, becoming the New York Times military correspondent in 1942. After the war, he reported for the Times from Moscow, Berlin, and London. Elizabeth Lee Miller, Condé Nast Publications war correspondent and photographer. Before the war, she had been a model and then a fashion photographer. During the war, she often worked on assignments with life photographer David E. Sherman. In 1944, she covered the fighting in Normandy and the liberation of Paris. In 1945, she photographed Buchenwald and Dachau concentration camps. Her post-war marriage to English artist Sir Roland Penrose gave her the title Lady Penrose. Jo Alex Morris joined United Press in 1928, became UP foreign editor in 1938, and later was named foreign editor of New York Herald Tribune. Edward J. Ed Murray, United Press correspondent in London. After the war, he helped found the Los Angeles Mirror and was its managing editor from 1948 to 1960. Edward R. Murrow, director of the CBS radio network in London. With the possible exceptions of Ernie Pyle and Hal Boyle, Murrow was the most famous journalist of World War II and is widely credited with inventing broadcast journalism. He was unsuccessful in his attempts to recruit Cronkite to CBS, but they later became colleagues at the network. In addition to his coverage of the Battle of Britain from London, Murrow is most famous for his early 1950s television series See It Now, especially for the episode challenging the credibility of anti-communist zealot Joseph McCarthy, senator from Wisconsin. Robert Bob Musso. With the United Press since 1927, he covered the Lindbergh kidnapping case and came to London in 1943 and reported on the air war and later the Battle of the Bulge. He also had a side career as lyricist of popular songs like Papa Piccolino. He lived in London until his death in 1999. Al Newman, Newsweek correspondent in London and a fraternity brother of Cronkite's. Eleanor and Reynolds Packard, married United Press correspondents who often worked together, covering the Italian invasion of Ethiopia in 1935 and the Spanish Civil War in 1936, and co-authoring Balkany Empire, Fascist Italy at War, 1942. They were nicknamed Pack and Peeby by their fellow journalists. John Paris, United Press correspondent in London who switched to the Associated Press in 1944. After the war, as columnist and editor at North Carolina's Asheville Citizen-Times, he became an expert on the state's mountain culture. Virgil Pinkley, senior United Press correspondent in London. He became European business manager of United Press in 1930 and was wounded while covering the Desert War in Libya in 1941. After the war, he was founding publisher of the Los Angeles Mirror and author of Eisenhower Declassified, 1979. Earl Poorbaugh, International News Service correspondent. Robert Perkins, post-New York Times correspondent in London who covered the Battle of Britain. A member of the Writing 69th, he was killed in the Wilhelmshaven raid. Wilmot Ragsdale, Time Life War correspondent who landed on Omaha Beach on D-Day plus one. He became a journalism professor at the University of Wisconsin-Madison in 1960. Bob Richards, United Press correspondent in London covering the air war. Bill Richardson, former United Press correspondent and managing editor of the U.S. Army magazine Yank in London. Stanley Richardson, NBC radio correspondent.
Ned Roberts, United Press correspondent in London, covering the air war.
Roy Roussel, major in the 8th Air Force. He was city editor of the Houston Press in the 1930s when Cronkite was starting out there as a reporter. Ned Russell, United Press correspondent in London. After the war, he worked for the New York Herald Tribune. Harrison Salisbury, United Press editor, Cronkite's boss in London, and later a New York Times foreign correspondent. His chapters on wartime London in his memoir, A Journey for Our Times, 1983, are filled with colorful anecdotes about Cronkite and many of the other correspondents Cronkite mentioned in his letters to Betsy. David E. Sherman, Life magazine photographer since 1936, who often worked with Condé Nast war correspondent Lee Miller. Before the United States entered the war, he had survived the sinking of his ship on the Atlantic by a Nazi surface raider, which was disguised as a merchant vessel. His photographs of the Nazi ship, published in Life, helped the Royal Navy track down and sink the raider. He remained at Life until the magazine's demise as a weekly in 1972 and edited the best-selling book, The Best of Life, 1973. Mel Schulstad, major in the 8th Air Force, decorated B-17 pilot, friend of Cronkite's. Bill Shadell, CBS radio reporter and a Murrow boy who covered the D-Day landings, the Battle of the Bulge, and the liberation of Buchenwald concentration camp. He later was a television anchor for ABC News. Josephine Sippy, Red Cross worker. Collie Small, United Press correspondent in London. He took over traveling to air bases for Cronkite in mid-1943 and later covered the fighting in France. Clayton Smith, major in 8th Air Force Public Relations. Jimmy Stewart, one of Hollywood's best-loved actors, for such movies as Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, 1939, as well as an experienced amateur pilot. He enlisted as a private in the Army Air Corps in 1941 and received his pilot's wings and a commission in 1942. While the Air Force wanted to restrict him to public relations activities, he campaigned for a combat assignment and was sent to the 8th Air Force in December 1943. He flew more than 20 combat missions, was twice awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross, and ended the war with the rank of colonel. Leland Stowe, Pulitzer Prize-winning foreign correspondent. He spent Christmas Day 1944 with Cronkite in Luxembourg. Sally Stronach, United Press London Bureau Secretary. Jack Tate, New York Herald Tribune correspondent. Henry J. Taylor, Scripps Howard foreign correspondent, later U.S. ambassador to Switzerland. Dixie Tai, International News Service correspondent in London, famed for her blunt language and flamboyant lifestyle, according to Nancy Caldwell Sorrell's History of Women Correspondents in World War II, The Women Who Wrote the War. Niles Trammell, president of NBC Radio Network. Joan Twelvetrees, British United Press correspondent. William Warren, Wade International News Service correspondent who arrived in London in 1941. A member of the Writing 69th, he set off on the Wilhelmshaven raid, but his plane developed engine trouble and turned back. After the war, served as bureau chief for Voice of America. Alfred Wagg, Chicago Tribune correspondent in London. Marcel Wallenstein, Kansas City Star correspondent in London. Bill Walton, Time correspondent and a fraternity brother of Cronkite's. He dropped into Normandy with paratroopers. Clarence George Pete Wellington, Kansas City Star editor. One of the cub reporters he taught the craft of journalism to was Ernest Hemingway. Merle McDougald Doug Werner, United Press correspondent in London who took over traveling to air bases for Cronkite in mid-1943. He landed on Utah Beach on June 6, 1944, and the dispatch he wrote that day was among the first published eyewitness accounts of the invasion. After the war, he covered the Nuremberg war crimes trials with Cronkite. He later joined the U.S. State Department as a press attaché. When he died in 2004 at age 91, he was the last surviving correspondent to have accompanied the D-Day landings. Jock John Hay Whitney, socially prominent investor serving in the Army Air Force as an intelligence officer. Taken prisoner by the Nazis in southern France in 1944, he escaped from the train carrying him to a POW camp. Joe Willicombe, International News Service correspondent. Tom Wolfe, reporter for the Newspaper Enterprise Association, a Scripps Howard syndicate, and an Acme European Bureau manager. William Wyler, prominent Hollywood director who won an Oscar for directing 1942's Mrs. Miniver, which also won 5 other Oscars, including one for Best Picture. In 1943, while a major in the Army Air Force, he made the documentary Memphis Belle, a story of a flying fortress, which told the story of the 8th Air Force's bombing campaign over occupied Europe. His 1946 feature film, The Best Years of Our Lives, about veterans returning to civilian life, won him a second Oscar for Best Director. Introduction. The giant I called Granddad. In the summer of 2010, a year after my grandfather died, my father and I went to the Lyndon Baines Johnson Library and Museum, which is located on the University of Texas at Austin campus. In collaboration with the Dolph Briscoe Center for American History, it had just opened an exhibition titled Cronkite, Eyewitness to a Century, encompassing my grandfather's life and career. Among other items, the exhibition featured the uniform he wore while serving as a foreign correspondent during World War II. We also spent several days looking through my grandfather's papers, deposited at the Briscoe Center. I was fascinated as I read his personal correspondence from the war years, especially the scores of letters that he wrote to my grandmother from Europe between 1943 and 1945. They reminded me strongly of the talks about World War II, and military history more generally, that my grandfather and I had shared as I was growing up. Recently, while watching the HBO series Band of Brothers, which features a company of paratroopers from the 101st Airborne during the war, I marveled at how often the story of Easy Company reminded me of the tales my grandfather told me about his own wartime experiences. He flew over Normandy on D-Day, not long after the paratroopers had jumped behind enemy lines. He landed in a glider in Holland with the 101st Airborne in Operation Market Garden, and afterward he was allowed to wear the 101st Airborne's Screaming Eagle shoulder patch insignia on his uniform. He survived the bombing of Eindhoven by the Luftwaffe on the night after it had been liberated by the Americans. He went on to cover the Battle of the Bulge, including the relief of the 101st during the siege of Bastogne. Those are just a few of the great stories that he told me. Co-author Maurice Isserman and I share those and many more in the chapters that follow, along with some of my own observations and experience growing up as his grandson, in the hope that they'll contribute to a more comprehensive picture of the man, his life, his family, and his career. Walter and Betsy Cronkite were both of solid Midwestern stock, born and raised in Kansas City, Missouri. The Maxwells, my grandmother's family, were a tough Scots-Irish clan. When she died in 2005, I visited Kansas City for her funeral, and my grandfather took us on a driving tour of their old haunts.
He was raised as an only child in a large house in a nice neighborhood.
My grandmother, the daughter of a postman, grew up in a very small house with many brothers and sisters. The Maxwells were gun enthusiasts, and my grandmother learned how to shoot as a girl. The family used their basement as a pistol shooting range until the foundation of the house started to crumble from the attrition of years of bullets fired. Her parents scraped together enough money to send her to the University of Missouri for a few semesters, but when the money ran dry, she had to drop out. After she got married, she finished her degree by taking night classes. Interestingly, my grandfather never finished his degree at the University of Texas, and he never felt the need to go back and complete it. But it was important to my grandmother to do so. Betsy Cronkite also had a professional career in journalism, and so my grandfather's correspondence with her should be heard not only as letters to his wife, but also as letters to a fellow reporter. She attended the University of Missouri School of Journalism and found a job at Kansas City's KCMO radio station as an advertising writer. In 1936, my grandfather became the station's news announcer. He later said that when he first saw her walk into the office, he was paralyzed by uncharacteristic shyness. The first time they conversed, they were both reading from a script that she had written for a commercial for the popular Richard Hudnut brand of cosmetics the station was scheduled to broadcast. After they finished reading the commercial script, my grandfather asked her out to lunch, and they married 4 years later. During the early years of the war, my grandmother was working as women's editor of the Kansas City Journal-Post, where, among other contributions, she wrote a column providing advice to the lovelorn. In the later years of the war, she worked as an editor and writer for Hallmark Cards. She remained an avid reader of newspapers all of her life. The effect that World War II had on my grandfather was far more profound, and provided the foundation for the rest of his illustrious career. In August 1963, he toured the beaches and cliffs of Normandy with Dwight D. Eisenhower, filming a CBS News special that would air on June 6, 1964, the 20th anniversary of the invasion of Normandy. The former war correspondent, who had faced enemy fire to report on the invasion from a bomber overhead, walked beside the commander who had led the monumental effort. And the two remembered the thousands of soldiers and sailors who had braved the infernal conditions on the ground that day. Millions of Americans, many of whom were World War II veterans, watched the show on their televisions. I was fortunate enough to hear my grandfather tell these stories in person many times over the years. World War II had vaulted him into the top ranks of American reporters. His wartime experience had taken him from the landing grounds of North Africa to bombing raids over occupied Europe, to crash landing in a glider behind enemy lines with the 101st Airborne, and to the Battle of the Bulge, and finally to the Nuremberg trials. But it wasn't until I traveled to the University of Texas to examine his archives did I realize what a defining role the war played in his life. One of my grandfather's favorite war stories took place during the Battle of the Bulge. Somehow he lost his helmet and it rolled into a minefield, and he decided he wasn't going to risk getting it back. He decided he would rather go around bareheaded, which was against regulations. So who should come driving down the road in a motorcade but General George S. Patton? Old Blood and Guts was a stickler for regulations, especially concerning dress. When he saw my grandfather without his helmet, General Patton ordered the motorcade to come to a screeching halt and, assuming W.C. was a soldier, got out to yell at him. General Patton was disappointed to find out that the object of his lesson was a correspondent, and he could not punish him. My grandfather spent all of 1943 stationed in London, covering the U.S. aerial war against Germany. The country had been bombed relentlessly during the German Blitz, and everyone who lived through that time faced shortages of all kinds. My grandfather's preoccupation with finding a decent meal, not surprising given the scarcities of wartime England, left a lasting mark on him. After the war, my grandparents loved going out to dinner with friends. In New York, they enjoyed mingling at the top restaurants of the day. When I was young, I remember them frequenting Le Cirque, Aquavit, La Côte Basque, and Caravelle. In his Christmas letter of 1943, he reminisces about going to the steakhouse Keane's with my grandmother while they were living in New York. They continued to eat at Keane's occasionally, and eventually my grandfather had his pipe hung on the wall, alongside pipes belonging to Teddy Roosevelt, Babe Ruth, Albert Einstein, and other notable patrons. Coffee was also scarce in wartime Britain, but that didn't bother my grandfather, who rarely drank it. My grandmother, in contrast, drank coffee all day long. She always bought Maxwell House coffee, probably because it shared the family name. W.C. preferred hot chocolate, and he drank milk with anything. In letters home from their time in Moscow in 1946 through 48, grandmother complained that they could never find fresh milk, only powdered. But she would mix it with cocoa or Ovaltine to make it palatable. When nighttime came, my grandparents, like many of their generation, enjoyed a good drink. Newspaper men were hard drinkers in those days, and some of them, like my grandfather's wartime friend and colleague Jim McClincy, battled a serious problem with alcohol. In his letters home to my grandmother, W.C. would note that he wasn't drinking nearly as much as the other reporters he socialized with. Some family history helps explain his need to reassure her on that score. During the First World War, his father, my great-great-grandfather, became an alcoholic. The family story is that he was fine before he went, but after enduring the horrors of that horrific war, he came out a changed man. Perhaps my grandfather wrote to Betsy to reassure her that he wasn't going to turn out like his own father. But he wasn't a teetotaler, and neither was my grandmother. At a restaurant, if a waiter informed her that they served only wine and beer, she would leap to her feet and lead the party out the door in search of a more hospitable venue. If my grandparents arrived at a party that didn't have liquor, they wouldn't stay for long. A shortage of another sort, at first my grandfather hardly had anything to wear, reveals a side of him that many people don't know about. W.C. placed a great deal of importance on personal appearance. He took the utmost care in his dress and grooming, believing it reflected outwardly the care a man took in his professional and personal life. He made sure the knot of his tie was always perfectly in place, his shirt cuffs were trim, his shoes were shined, etc. After the war, he wore tailored Brooks Brothers suits and Hermes ties. My grandmother, too, was extremely well-dressed, always choosing, with help from her personal shopper at Bergdorf's, classic styles. According to my mother, my grandmother loved Adolfo, and my grandfather gave her an Adolfo suit every year. She wore Ferragamo shoes, and her winter coats were lined with fur. She had beautiful red hair that stayed red until she was in her 90s, and she liked emerald green clothes because they complemented her green eyes. For the same reason, my grandfather always gave her jade jewelry. She wore the jade engagement ring he bought for her in Kansas City until the day she died, along with her platinum wedding ring.
My grandfather wore his San Jacinto High School ring until the day he died.
They were a glamorous couple who enjoyed living well in New York, but they never forgot where they came from. All who knew them well were aware that they remained in personality and values a down-home, middle American couple. Nowhere is that better reflected than in the humor that appears in so many of their wartime letters. My grandparents, till the end of their lives, were constantly ribbing each other and sharing jokes. My grandfather's letters to her are full of puns, and he never lost his taste for the art. It's a shame that Betsy's wartime letters to my grandfather didn't survive, because I suspect they would reveal a similar sense of humor. Every time someone told her, "Mrs. Cronkite, please walk this way," she would respond tartly with the old vaudeville line, "If I could walk that way, I wouldn't need talcum powder." And when she walked into some public event, she'd say skeptically, "Ballroom? There's hardly elbow room." My grandfather was a favorite target of her jokes. He became hard of hearing in his old age, but instead of regarding his infirmity solemnly, my grandmother treated it as just another foible to laugh about. She would silently mouth words at him from across the dinner table, causing him to pop out his hearing aid to check the batteries, to the delight of the grandchildren in attendance. In his memoir, A Reporter's Life, my grandfather wrote that he attributed the duration of their marriage to Betsy's extraordinarily keen sense of humor, which saw us over many bumps, mostly of my making, and her tolerance, even support, for the uncertain schedule and wanderings of a newsman. Her humor was one of the things he loved about her. The letters show, however, that he suffered the most at Christmas time. They spent 3 Christmases apart between 1942 and the end of the war. He never forgot how deprived he felt during those lonely holidays. In later years, my grandfather was an enthusiastic and sentimental celebrator of Christmas. He always went all out. The whole family would gather at my grandparents' townhouse on East 84th Street on Christmas Eve to sing Christmas carols around the piano. Good King Wenceslas was a favorite. And then we would have a lavish dinner, followed by Stollen, the traditional German cake, in homage to my grandfather's maternal German ancestry. On Christmas Day, we would open the door to find the living room filled wall to wall with presents. My grandfather took a childlike delight in unwrapping presents, and he instituted a custom of elaborately wrapping a great many trinkets in order to have as many gifts to open as possible. My grandmother loved filling the stockings with tangerines and marzipan and other penny shop gifts. Apart from what my grandfather's wartime letters tell us about his personal life, they reveal a great deal about his professional life. Friends, family, and colleagues alike knew that he was an extremely competitive man who loved to win. The letters reveal many instances of this. Later on, he would proudly tell his grandkids stories of scooping the competition, Chet Huntley and David Brinkley at NBC in the 1960s, and Barbara Walters at ABC in the late 1970s. During summers on Martha's Vineyard, he loved playing board games such as Monopoly, Risk, and Diplomacy. Unlike many celebrities, W.C. never grew tired of accepting awards, great or small. He was genuinely thrilled to be honored at the most obscure and humble institutions. His dining room in Martha's Vineyard was furnished with the chairs he had been awarded along with his honorary doctorates. Competitive as my grandfather was, he didn't care as much about the amount of money he was paid. The letters tell the story of how he was offered the chance to work for CBS Radio by Edward R. Murrow at a higher salary, but turned it down to stay with the United Press because he liked his job. My grandfather later became well paid by CBS as a reporter and an anchorman. But it was only after he had retired that anchors' salaries skyrocketed. Given a choice of negotiating terms, he would always ask for more time off, especially in the summer, rather than for more money. He even had a joking competition with Johnny Carson to see who could get more time off from his respective network. At the funeral of Dick Salent, president of CBS News, Mike Wallace told the story of going to ask him for a raise, and Salent saying, "So you think you should get more money than Cronkite gets?" Wallace responded, "Oh, I guess not." So, in a way, he held down all the other broadcasters' salaries. Like many people who grew up during the Depression, W.C. was thrifty, an inclination reinforced by the scarcity of World War II. I remember he would say, "Use it up and wear it out. Make it do or do without." He would keep a car on the road until it fell apart. Whenever I rode in the back seat of one of his cars with my cousins, we would fight over who would get to sit next to the one window that still rolled down. The window on the other side was permanently stuck. My grandfather could make do with less because material goods didn't matter to him. What drove him was the zeal to be the best reporter around. He had no illusions, however, about the difference between him and the heroic soldiers he was covering. During the war, he took numerous risks as part of his job as a correspondent. But as he made clear to my grandmother, flying in bombers, landing in a glider, and coming under enemy fire were not adventures he enjoyed or intended to repeat if he could avoid it. W.C. told me wryly that the only time he was ever wounded in the war was during the liberation of Amsterdam. The joyful citizens were throwing tulips bound in wire at their liberators, and one bunch struck him in the cheek and drew blood. Still, in peacetime, he continued to be a risk-taker. In the early 1950s, he began driving race cars. As his family grew and CBS needed to provide him with life insurance, my grandmother and his bosses at the television station finally convinced him to take up the less dangerous sport of sailing. Starting in the 1960s, he kept buying bigger and fancier cabin sailboats. The first three were all named Chipper, after my father, and his later sailboats were all called Wintje, the name of the first woman living in New Amsterdam in the 17th century who married a Cronkite. The Cronkites trace our ancestry back to the Dutch settlers of New Amsterdam. Before the days of GPS, he could figure out his nautical position by charts and dead reckoning. He kept a cool head when sailing, even during several hair-raising storms. He was out sailing with his buddy, Mike Ashford, in October 1991 in the waters off Martha's Vineyard, when they ran into the famous perfect storm. They made it back through the violent waves to harbor safely, and I remember Ashford, who had been an Air Force bomber pilot, saying it was one of the most terrifying outings of his life. World War II made my grandfather the man he was. He was already smart, competitive, and driven, but the war made him tough, worldly, and thoughtful. He was catapulted from a promising but obscure wire service reporter in the Midwest to an internationally famous war correspondent. In the early days of the war, his greatest ambition was merely an overseas assignment.
By the war's close, he was discussing with my grandmother which European capital he would be assigned to as United Press bureau chief.
When I read these letters between my grandparents, I am reminded of how young they were when they were separated. My grandfather was 25, only a year older than I am now, when he left for the war. People in that generation had to grow up fast, and he handled the chaotic wartime situation adeptly. I knew Walter and Betsy as grandparents who were always a joy to be around, smart, fast-paced, funny, at times outrageously hilarious. They were also both incredibly kind people who were still very much in love. In reading the letters, I can hear their voices still, only refracted through the distance of time. Back then, they were two young lovers, torn apart by the greatest war the world has ever known. Walter Cronkite IV.
Chapter 1. A Pretty Personal Matter. Tomorrow is our fourth anniversary. The first 2 years seemed to go so quickly, and the last two have dragged so horribly. 2 whole years out of our lives. It makes this war with Hitler a pretty personal matter. Walter Cronkite to Betsy Cronkite, March 29, 1944. On March 30, 1940, a 23-year-old reporter named Walter Leland Cronkite, Jr. married fellow journalist Mary Elizabeth Betsy Maxwell in Grace and Holy Trinity Episcopal Church in Kansas City, Missouri, following a 4-year courtship. Their marriage lasted happily for 65 years until her death in 2005. Shortly after the young couple celebrated their second anniversary, Walter Cronkite was credentialed as a war correspondent for the United Press Wire Service. They spent many weeks apart in the summer and fall of 1942, as Cronkite twice sailed on convoys across submarine-infested waters, first to Britain and then to North Africa. After a brief reunion in New York City in early December, Cronkite shipped out on an overseas assignment. This time, the two were not reunited until 28 months later. Cronkite consoled himself in the meantime by writing Betsy long, detailed letters, sometimes 5 in a week, narrating his experiences as a war correspondent, his observations of life in wartime Europe, and his longing for her. For Walter and Betsy Cronkite, as for millions of other young men and women in those years, the war with Hitler was a pretty personal matter, as well as an event of world historical importance. Betsy Cronkite carefully saved her husband's letters, copying many to circulate among family and friends.
More than 100 of his letters from 1943 to 1945 survive and are archived in the Walter Cronkite papers at the Dolph Briscoe Center for American History at the University of Texas at Austin.
For the rest of his life, during which he served for 19 years as anchorman for CBS Evening News, Walter Cronkite reflected on his experiences reporting from Europe on the Second World War. In addition, by producing and narrating numerous television series and specials about the war, Cronkite helped shape, and in the process became thoroughly identified in the American mind with, historical memories of the Good War and the Greatest Generation. Walter Cronkite, Jr. was born on November 4, 1916, in St. Joseph, Missouri, the son of Walter Leland Cronkite, a dentist, and Helen Fritchie Cronkite. The family moved to Kansas City in 1918, when Walter Cronkite, Sr. returned from his military service in World War I, and then to Houston in 1926.
Walter, Jr. graduated from San Jacinto High School in 1933, entering the University of Texas at Austin that fall as a journalism major.
His parents divorced soon afterward and both remarried. While a student at the University of Texas, Cronkite cut his teeth as a journalist by working on the campus newspaper, the Daily Texan, and taking part-time jobs with a number of local and state newspapers. His favorite and best-paying job was the 3 hours a day he put in as an assistant to the Houston Press's political correspondent in Austin. As Cronkite wrote to his parents in an early 1935 letter, preserved in the archives at the University of Texas, "The $5 I collect from the Houston Press tomorrow for the past week's work is going into a bank fund, as is each week's salary. If I can keep said funds in bank, then, by the end of school, I should have quite a sum accumulated. Possibly this new job with the press will give me the influence to get some sort of world trip out of MIFO." Marcellus E. MIFO Foster, editor of the Houston Press from 1927 to 1937. "I would like to sell them on the idea of getting me a job on a boat, then giving me $5 a week to write experiences as a young man sees the world." Bored by his classes and eager to begin making his way in the world of professional journalism, Cronkite dropped out of the university following the spring semester of 1935 and went to work, first in the Austin Bureau of the International News Service, and then in the Austin Scripps Howard Bureau, which provided coverage for the chain's newspapers in the state. In the fall of 1935, he moved to Houston to take a full-time job with the Houston Press. Over the next few years, he moved from job to job, sometimes working for newspapers, sometimes for radio stations, and including one stint in the public relations office of Braniff Airlines. While he was working as an announcer with radio station KCMO in Kansas City in 1936, he met Betsy Maxwell, his future bride. In 1937, he joined the wire service United Press as a reporter, and although he left for other positions, he returned in 1939. He spent the next 10 years as a UP reporter, 6 of them as a foreign correspondent. As his 1935 letter to his parents suggests, Cronkite was a young man with big dreams. He would get his chance to see the world while still a young reporter, but not in the way he expected. The United Press assigned Cronkite to the night shift of its Kansas City bureau. He was in the UP office the night of September 1, 1939, when news arrived that Germany was attacking Poland. Within days, Britain and France declared war on Nazi Germany. The war settled into months of watchful waiting on both sides, a period referred to at the time as the Phony War. But the war turned deadly in April 1940, when Hitler launched his blitzkrieg assault on Western Europe, conquering Norway, Denmark, the Netherlands, Belgium, and France in short order. British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain stepped down from office in disgrace in early May 1940. His successor, Winston Churchill, oversaw the evacuation of the British Army from the French port at Dunkirk in the first days of June. The Nazis were now undisputed masters of Europe, from central Poland to the English Channel. In August, the Luftwaffe launched a concentrated bombing assault on Britain in preparation for an invasion across the English Channel. The stiff resistance of the Royal Air Force in the Battle of Britain, however, forced Hitler to postpone his invasion plans. Instead, the following summer, Hitler the Führer vastly increased the scope of the war by invading the Soviet Union. In the United States, isolationists and internationalists debated how to respond to the threat of Nazi aggression. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt cautiously but steadily increased U.S. aid to Britain, and after June 22, 1941, to the Soviet Union. The Lend-Lease Program, enacted in March 1941, authorized shipment of American military supplies to Allied nations. Within months, American destroyers were accompanying merchant vessels carrying supplies to Britain. By the fall, the U.S. Navy was engaged in an undeclared shooting war with German U-boats. On December 7, 1941, on the other side of the globe, the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, revoking an American declaration of war the following day. Germany and Italy declared war on the United States in solidarity with their Axis partner Japan, and the United States responded in kind. In the last months of peace, Cronkite and his wife had enrolled in the newly established civilian pilot training program, designed to create a pool of trained pilots. Betsy Cronkite got her pilot's license. Her husband, it turned out, was colorblind, and was thus disqualified. The disability also meant that Cronkite would not be drafted. But after Pearl Harbor, he was eager to get as close to the war as he could, requesting an overseas assignment. His bosses at the United Press, recognizing his potential, transferred him from Kansas City to New York City in May 1942, a first step toward becoming a military correspondent. Shortly after his arrival, he wrote to his mother, Helen Cronkite, to say that he was putting in 10-hour days rewriting the cables that foreign correspondents sent in to the New York office. His own future remained uncertain. "I still have absolutely no conception of what the United Press intends doing with me." Joe Alex Morris, the foreign news editor who had me brought into New York, admits that he is confused by the return of all our correspondents who had been interned in the Axis countries, and he adds that he may not know himself what to do with me for another couple of weeks. "I'd still like to go abroad, but I like this town so well that I wouldn't mind too much being told to just stay here." Sometime in the next few months, Cronkite received the necessary credentials from the U.S. Navy to accompany a convoy across the North Atlantic to Britain. The Battle of the Atlantic was raging, as German U-boats sank a sickening number of Allied merchant and troop transport convoys and their naval escorts. It was vital to the Allied cause to secure their lines of supply and reinforcement from the New World to Britain. Yet, Allied air patrols, crucial to the detection and destruction of marauding packs of U-boats, were unable to operate in mid-ocean, leaving an exposed gap in which the Germans concentrated their attacks. More than 1,000 Allied merchant ships were lost in the North Atlantic alone in 1942. Later on in the war, New long-range patrol planes, equipped with radar and other electronic detection devices, turned the tide of battle. The number of Allied ships sunk in the North Atlantic the following year was reduced to just over 300. In 1944, it was just over 100. In the late summer of 1942, Cronkite got his first chance to realize his youthful dream of seeing the world as a reporter when he was assigned to a company Task Force 38, a troop transport convoy voyaging from New York to Greenock, Scotland. He traveled aboard the USS Arkansas, a 32-year veteran of the Navy's battleship fleet. The convoy set sail from New York on August 6, 1942, and reached Greenock on August 17, returning to New York on September 4. 2 days later, Cronkite wrote home to his mother to report on the adventure. The trip was swell. As perhaps you have learned, I was in the biggest convoy ever to cross the Atlantic. The only newspaper man on the trip, I occupied the admiral's cabin on the escorting battleship. Private bedroom, lounge with desk, and private bath all on the main deck. We encountered no enemy action, and the weather, although extremely cold in the North Atlantic, was rather calm. The last couple of days on the way over, we ran into some roughness, but apparently I'm not subject to seasickness, and I weathered it with no difficulty. We were 10 days in the British Isles, during which I saw London, a couple of counties south of London, Edinburgh, and Glasgow in Scotland. At most of those spots, I stayed in the American officer clubs. All the British Isles cities are filled with Americans, it seems, and had a gay time. In London, I visited with newspaper friends, some of whom I had known back here, and toured the usual tourist sites and bombed areas. The trip back was just like a cruise as far as the weather was concerned. In fact, it was just a little boring. We did get a little action, however, about which I'm sorry I can't tell you just yet. I've got a pretty good story on my hands when and if I can fight it through censorship. Cronkite's pretty good story, which was datelined September 3rd and ran in American newspapers on September 9th, concerned the burning of the Navy transport ship USS Wakefield, which Cronkite witnessed from the deck of the Arkansas. The Wakefield, formerly the luxury liner SS Manhattan, was returning to the United States from England when it caught fire. All hands and passengers were rescued, although the ship was reduced to a burned-out hulk. After extensive repairs in Boston Harbor, the ship was returned to duty in the spring of 1944. "My story, by some miracle, got past the censors," Cronkite wrote in his 1996 memoir, A Reporter's Life, "and made the banner headline in a lot of American papers. I had lucked into early recognition as a war correspondent." Cronkite wrote a few other stories during the trip, including glimpses of wartime life in London. The main story, about the convoy itself, fell a little flat. As suggested in its lead sentence, a successful convoy is a boring convoy. Cronkite's second overseas assignment that fall provided better material, as he covered the first combat landing of American troops outside the Pacific Theater. President Roosevelt and his military advisers were eager to engage the Nazis in Europe, hoping to take pressure off the Red Army, which was bearing the brunt of the fight against Hitler's armies. But the British adamantly opposed what they regarded as a premature and potentially disastrous landing on the European continent. As an alternative, Churchill proposed an Anglo-American invasion of French North Africa, with landings in Morocco and Algeria, then controlled by the collaborationist Vichy government in France. From there, the Allies could move eastward through Tunisia, netting German and Italian forces in North Africa in a pincer attack, coordinated with British forces already stationed in Egypt and Libya. It wasn't quite the full-scale second front that Roosevelt and his advisers had hoped for, but at least Americans were fighting the Nazis, which was important as a symbol of American resolve in the European theater. On October 19, 1942, Cronkite found himself flying in a Navy transport plane from New York to Norfolk, Virginia, to join the convoy loading men and supplies for Operation Torch, the invasion of North Africa. "And now the story begins to unfold," Cronkite wrote excitedly the next day in a journal he kept during the assignment. "And what a terrific story! What an amazing assignment! This, it begins to appear, is the second front. The convoy set sail on October 23, 1942, part of the Northern Attack Group commanded by General George S. Patton, with overall command of the invasion entrusted to Lieutenant General Dwight D. Eisenhower. Cronkite crossed the Atlantic aboard the battleship USS Texas. His assignment during the invasion was to cover the Navy's role in the operation. Other correspondents were assigned to go with the landing forces to the beaches and beyond. Secretly, he planned to jump ship after the initial landing and help cover any ground fighting. Although the invasion planners hoped that the Vichy French forces would refrain from firing and switch sides against the Germans. Cronkite celebrated his 26th birthday, November 4, 1942, en route, 4 days before the scheduled landings. On November 8, the landing craft headed for shore. The ships did not unleash a preliminary naval bombardment, again hoping that the French would welcome the invasion. But those hopes were disappointed, and 3 days of costly fighting ensued. Eventually, the big guns of the USS Texas were brought to bear on the French lines. Cronkite went ashore with a naval party to assess the effectiveness of the bombardment, which turned out to have missed its intended target, a French ammunition dump. Cronkite might have stayed on shore as part of his plan to cover the U.S. ground assault, but he heard that the Texas was sailing to Casablanca, where more fighting was expected. Once aboard the ship, he discovered, to his dismay, that it was heading directly back to the U.S., cutting short his coverage of the invasion. Making the best of a bad situation, he decided he could still claim a scoop by being the first war correspondent to return to the U.S. from North Africa. The problem was that a correspondent from the International News Service was also headed home, aboard a ship scheduled to arrive before the Texas. Cronkite stole a march on his rival by hitching a ride on the Texas's catapult-launched observation float plane when they were within flying distance of Norfolk, Virginia. From there, he hitched another ride to New York City. After the emotional telephone calls to Betsy and my mother in Kansas City, he wrote in a reporter's life, I sat down to rewrite my previous stories, which had been radioed from the Texas to Allied military headquarters on Gibraltar, but had not been forwarded to the States as planned. They hit the wires with an editor's note saying that I was the first correspondent back from North Africa, and these were the first uncensored stories from that historic landing. Cronkite's report, proudly labeled by the United Press as the exclusive account of how the Americans took Port Lioti in a bitter 3-day battle, was datelined November 11th and ran in American newspapers 2 weeks later. Betsy, who had moved back to Kansas City when her husband left for North Africa, joined her husband in New York City at the end of November, but their time together was brief. 1 year later, on December 12, 1943, Cronkite wrote to Betsy to mark the anniversary of their latest separation. Another gloomy Sunday, this time made even lonelier by the fact that it is just a year ago today that I left you on this last, longest trip of all. I knew then, when they said I was going to London, that the easy days of the Navy assignment with frequent returns to the United States were over. But I held a secret hope, almost a belief, that nothing could really keep us apart for long, and that somehow we would be together before many more months had passed. Well, now it has been a year, and although some say the end is in sight, it still seems to be a far stretch down the road. Every day of this last year, and every day until we are together again, I miss you more, love you more, and am more lonely for you. It hasn't been much fun. It won't be fun until we can be together again. Their next reunion was still a long, long time in the future. The letters to Betsy between 1943 and 1945 that are reprinted in the chapters that follow provide a vivid record of the Cronkites' personal war.
Chapter 2. The Writing 69th. January through May 1943. In the winter and spring of 1943, Walter Cronkite's life changed forever. When he arrived in London 2 days before New Year's Day, he was an obscure United Press correspondent. By March, as he marveled in a letter to Betsy, he found himself a celebrity. He was assigned to cover the fast-expanding air offensive by the U.S. 8th Air Force against Nazi Germany,
the biggest story in the European theater of operations. Less than 2 months after arriving in England, he risked his life in accompanying a dangerous bombing mission against the U-boat base at Wilhelmshaven, Germany. His letters home chronicle his professional advance, as well as the personal side of life as a correspondent in wartime London. The letters also reveal Cronkite's acute unhappiness because of his separation from his wife. Cronkite shipped out from New York on December 11, 1942, for a hazardous journey across the Atlantic aboard the 25-year-old Dutch passenger ship Westernland. German U-boats attacked the convoy, sinking several of the slow-going and vulnerable freighters and tankers, but the Westernland reached port in Glasgow unscathed. Despite his relief at the safe passage, Cronkite wrote on arrival that the trip aboard the old crate was abominable from every other standpoint. The British Isles were the staging area for a planned two-pronged Allied assault on Nazi-ruled Europe. The air war had already been launched, and the cross-channel invasion of France was eagerly awaited, though it would not take place for another year and a half. Cronkite was one of the 3 million Americans, most of them young men in uniform, who made the lone Allied outpost in Western Europe their home between January 1942 and June 1944. Cronkite reminded Betsy in his first letter from Britain that their correspondence would be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.